Balance sheet and income statement are perhaps two of the most important financial statements for any company in any industry, whether it's a large company or small. So in this video, we're going to have a look at what is a balance sheet and an income statement, and we'll have a look at a few examples, starting, of course, with the balance sheet. Basically, the balance sheet is a bit of a snapshot, a bit of a picture of what's going on in the company. A picture shows you what's happening to whatever you're taking a picture of at the given moment in time. For example, if you take a picture of your activities, it shows you what you were doing at that particular moment. It doesn't show you what you have been doing over an hour, over a day, over a week. Instead, it only shows the situation at the given moment in time. And the balance sheet is something similar to that. Balance sheet shows what's happening to the company at that particular moment in time. For example, if we're looking at a balance sheet in an annual statement, perhaps for 31st of December, then that balance sheet shows exactly what's happening in the company just on that particular day, not on what has been happening in the company during that year. And more specifically, the details of a balance sheet include assets. Usually assets are placed on the left-hand side of the balance sheet. Usually a balance sheet is split into two sides, left and right. Left-hand side usually includes the assets. Right-hand side includes the liabilities or the debts that the company has, as well as the equity or the net capital of the company. Now, more specifically, looking at each side of the balance sheet, let's start with the assets. Let's start with the left side. Usually the assets are listed in the balance sheet in an order of decreasing liquidity. As we see on this example, at the top of the balance sheet, we have current assets, the assets that are quite liquid, that are easy to sell. And lower down the list of assets, we have longer term assets such as factories and trucks that aren't as easy or quick to sell. Hence, the liquidity is just the ability of any kind of asset to be converted into cash, basically to be sold quickly and easily without losing too much value. And looking at the right side of the balance sheet, looking at the liabilities and debts, those are listed in order of when they're due to be paid, with the shorter term loans, with the shorter term liabilities near the top of this list, and longer term debts, longer term liabilities near the bottom of that list. But at the very bottom of the right hand side, once we've finished with all the liabilities, once we've finished with listing all the debts, we have shareholder equity or net worth or capital of the company. And of course, because this is a balance sheet, from the word you perhaps might guess that the left side and the right side, they should balance. So that brings you to perhaps the most important thing about a balance sheet, and I want to emphasize that, is the balance equation, where the assets are equal to total liabilities plus total equity. This equation is perhaps the most basic one in accounting, so it's a good idea to be aware of it. Next, looking at some more details of assets versus liabilities, especially looking at the top side of these lists, both on the right-hand side and on the left-hand side, I want to mention that is also pretty important, which is the net working capital. Usually, net working capital should be positive for a healthy firm. Net working capital is the difference between current assets and current liabilities. Remember, current liabilities are basically the liabilities, the debts that the company would have to pay pretty soon. And if the short-term assets cannot cover that, if the short-term assets do not exceed current liabilities, then sometime soon, over the next short term, whenever these short-term liabilities are due to be paid, the company might experience some difficulties. So we want the net working capital to be positive for a healthy firm. That's because this firm will need that liquidity to pay for the upcoming short-term liabilities. And that's an indication that net working capital is, of course, related to liquidity, which helps the company to avoid those difficulties, which helps the company to avoid financial distress. And the difficulty is in a bit of a trade-off, because if the company will have too much liquidity, they would be giving up some of profitability. So there is a trade-off between liquidity of the assets versus perhaps tying up the assets in a less liquid form with some sort of investments that are profitable. So there is a trade-off between liquidity and profitability. For example, if the firm has millions and millions in cash just lying around, just sitting around, that will not generate much profits. Whereas if those millions were deployed, were used to build some sort of a factory, that factory could generate profits for the firm. So that's one sort of trade-off that financial managers would face. Another one is how much debt to take within the company versus how much equity to hold. For a given total assets, for a given company size of, let's say, 100 million, the company might have 30% in debt, 30 million, versus 70 million in owner's equity. Or instead, even for the same company size of 100 million, it might have more in debt, say 70% in debt, 70 million in debt, versus only 30%, 30 million in owner's money, in owner's equity. This decision usually would depend a lot on the type of industry the company is in. And of course, that decision sort of relates to our balance sheet equation, which after you rearrange it a little bit, tells you that owner's equity is equal to the difference between assets and total liabilities. Next, let's have a look at a couple of examples of a balance sheet. Let's start with one we create on our own. Assets on the left-hand side, liabilities and equity on the right-hand side. For the relatively liquid assets, we could have cash and accounts receivable. Perhaps inventory could also go there. For less liquid assets, for long-term or fixed assets, perhaps we could have something like factory equipment, and let's say trucks and vehicles, and perhaps some other assets as well. Let's throw in some numbers. Perhaps this is in millions of dollars, giving us a total of 500, perhaps in millions. On the liabilities side, we could have something like accounts payable. Perhaps these are the short-term debts we have to pay to our suppliers. We could also have notes payable. These are relatively short-term loans from the banks. We could have some lease obligations, perhaps some cars borrowed, which we have to pay the lease on relatively soon. And perhaps we have some benefits, employee compensation obligations that we also have to pay to our employees relatively soon. So all of these are our current liabilities. Let's move equities a bit lower because we need space for longer term liabilities, which could be some long-term debts, perhaps some deferred tax payments that we'll have to pay somewhat later on, perhaps some sort of longer term bonds that will also have to be paid out somewhat later. And of course, bonds are just another form of debt. Let's throw in some numbers for our short-term and long-term liabilities and move on to our owner's equity, which might consist of paid-in capital, the capital that was actually contributed by the owners, plus some retained earnings. Those are the previous profits that went back into the company for the company growth. Let's throw in some numbers. And of course, the numbers are such that the balance, it balances, such that on the left-hand side, total assets are equal to the total liabilities plus total owner's equity. In this example, each are 500, say millions. Let's have a look at one more example from the real world. This is a Q2 statement for this year from Newmont. That's currently the largest gold mining company in the world. And here's the balance sheet for Newmont. Here's a good example of a balance sheet where it splits to top versus bottom rather than left and right sides. The assets are near the top and liabilities and equity are near the bottom. And as you see, the assets are listed in a decreasing liquidity, starting from cash and cash equivalents, investments and inventories, and going down into a longer term fixed assets such as property, plant and mine development, stockpiles of ore, which can't be sold immediately because it will first have to be processed into purer form of gold and so on. Moving on to liabilities, again, those are listed from short-term into longer-term liabilities, as you see on this particular example. And in the equity, we do have our paid-in capital, retained earnings, and other forms of equity. And of course, this balance sheet does balance. The total assets of 40.677 is equal to total debt with some contingencies plus total liabilities. Again, adding up to 40.677. And finally, let's have a look at an income statement. Unlike a balance sheet, which shows you a snapshot of what's going on at the moment in time, income statement shows you what has been happening in the company over a period of time. Perhaps you could have a look at an income statement over the last quarter, or an annual income statement would show you what has been the financial performance of the company over that year. So let's have a look at this example of a bathtub with some running water. If you want to ask about the amount of water, that's more of a stock variable in economics. That's more relevant to a balance sheet sort of example, where you're asking how much water is at a given moment in time, because the quantity of water changes from one moment to the next. So if you ask me how much water is in the tap, I could say that there are, let's say, 20 liters right now. After a minute or two, there will be a different amount of water. That's a bit like a snapshot of how much water is there. So that's a bit more like a balance sheet sort of question. Income statement is more relevant to this flow of water over time rather than at a given moment in time. If you ask me anything about the flow of water, that question would relate to a period of time. I would say something like perhaps the water is flowing at the rate of 2 liters a minute. In this case, we use a minute as the period of time. So this sort of question is more relevant to an income statement sort of question, which in economics is a flow type of variable. And looking inside an income statement, you'd see that the revenue is on the top of the income statement, followed by all the costs and expenses that are deducted, that are subtracted from the revenue, leaving us at the end with the profits or net income. So as I mentioned, revenue is at the top. We then subtract all the costs and expenses from that revenue, leaving us at the end with net income or profits, which is then actually divided into dividends paid to the shareholders, paid to the owners of the company, and the rest of the profits that stays within the company, helps the company grow in size, goes into the owner's equity part of the balance sheet as additions to retained earnings. And one thing to emphasize, one thing to highlight here in relation to the income statement is the income statement equation, which says that the net income or the profits is equal to the revenue minus all costs and expenses and taxes. So let's have a look at an illustration of that. We take the revenue, which might be called differently in different income statements. In this case, it's net sales of 1,509, minus all the costs and expenses, such as cost of goods sold, depreciation, gives you earnings before interest and tax. This is a common thing that we will mention many times during this course, so we'll often abbreviate this as EBIT, which is equal to $694 in this example, minus interest expense gives you EBT, which is earnings before tax, in this case, $624. And the tax is applied to EBT. Tax is applied to taxable income of $624, which is this earnings before interest and tax. So the tax does not usually apply, at least let's have a convention for this course. The tax does not usually apply to all of the revenue, although the rules change from one country to the next. The tax usually applies to the earnings before tax, EBT. You might also call them taxable income. And let's say in this example, the tax rate is 33.974 of a percent, giving us $212 of taxes on the EBT of $624. And 624 minus 212 gives us profits or net income of $412, which let's say for this company is divided into dividends of $103 and additions to retained earnings of $309. This division of profits into dividends and additions to retained earnings simply depends on the company policy, on the dividend policy. In this case, it looks like the dividend payout is one quarter. One quarter of all profits are paid out as dividends, and the rest is retained within the company. Next, let's have a look at another example of an income statement with a bit of a relevance to the real world example. Calculating net income in an income statement. And I'm going to use an example of McDonald's Corporation to make this a little bit more interesting, not as dry as you have it in the textbook. So here's the income statement for McDonald's. At the top, you would have revenue. In this case, we have different kinds of revenues. Revenues from the restaurants operated by McDonald's Corporation and revenues from franchised restaurants, some other kinds of revenue. I simplified over here in our Excel sheet with just, say, sales revenue for some generic company. After that, you'd have some kind of expenses, different types of expenses, starting with operating expenses, expenses that are directly related to running the business. In case of McDonald's, that would include all the costs of buying, say, potatoes and meat for those hamburgers and chips that you might buy in the restaurant. For our generic example, I'm going to call it cost of goods sold. And for this cost of goods sold, I'm going to combine these three numbers. So if you add up these three numbers, you'd have 2036.2. That's probably in millions. And by the way, this income statement is for the second quarter of this year. Then you have other operating expenses that are kind of layered on a sub-level here, including depreciation and other expenses, admin expenses. I'm going to keep it simple here, keep one layer of expenses. I'm going to have depreciation at 71 and admin and the say marketing expenses. I'm going to allocate these two numbers, $693.2 million, into admin expenses and marketing expenses. Say 300 for admin and the rest for marketing. That would allow me to calculate earnings before interest and tax. I would do that by taking the sales revenue and subtracting all the operating costs. You'd see that called earnings before interest and tax in the textbook, and we see that as operating income in our McDonald's example. There are, of course, some other expenses not directly related to running the business or to operating the business. Let's simplify this a little bit into just simply interest expense. As a corporation actually seems to have some income as well, maybe from selling some securities or maybe from interest on some cash deposits in the bank. Whatever, I'm gonna take a net of this and just call it interest expense, 312.4. That would allow me to calculate earnings before tax. That's how you'd often see it called in the textbook. In our example, we have it as income before provision for income taxes. That's simply EBIT minus interest expense. 648.7 and 648.7. Let's have tax payment at 164.9. And finally, net income equal to earnings before tax minus tax payments. 483.8, same as in the income statement for McDonald's. I hope it's helpful. Read through the lecture notes online and have a nice day.